First of all, let me take this opportunity to thank the organizers for inviting me for this conference, especially Kishen and Sasi and Dua. So my presentation is actually on financial inclusion in Sri Lanka, particularly looking at the current status and issues that needs to be addressed. So first I will provide an overview of the financial sector in Sri Lanka, and then we'll look at where Sri Lanka stands with regard to financial inclusion or the financial access in comparison to other Asian countries. And then next I will present some of the key findings based on a panel household survey, that actually a small household survey that I carried out in two periods covering three districts of the country, and then finally issues and challenges. So currently there are a large number of different financial institutions providing financial services to different segments of the population. Broadly we can categorize them as formal financial institutions and semi-formal financial institutions. So formal financial institutions are primarily banks, including licensed commercial banks and licensed specialized banks, and leasing and finance companies that are coming under the purview of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. And in addition, there are a large number of semi-formal financial institutions, including cooperatives, various non-governmental organizations and CBOs, community-based organizations, and also the Samurdhi Banking Societies. This is a state-run microfinance program, which is a part of the main poverty alleviation program, and it is also linked to the country's largest cash transfer program. So I will talk about all these different types of players in detail later in my presentation. So giving you a kind of an overview of the banking sector in Sri Lanka, currently there are 34 licensed banks, including 22 domestic banks and 12 foreign banks, with a branch network of around 6,500. This is including special student savings units. And on average, there are 17 bank branches per every 100,000 persons. This is only the regulated banks which come under the purview of the Central Bank of Sri Lanka. So in recent years, there has been an increase in the density of banks in the country from around 10 to 17 per 100,000 between 2009 and 2014. And we can see this increase in the density of banks across all the 9 provinces in the country. So along with the increase or the growth of the banking sector, there has also been an expansion in the finance and leasing sector of the country. As you can see, over the last 5 years, the number of branches of the leasing and finance companies have almost doubled. And interestingly, there has been a growth of leasing and finance company branches across all the districts between 2010 and 2014. In some provinces, the numbers have almost doubled. So as I mentioned earlier, there are also a large number of semi-formal financial institutions. So currently there are 2 large networks of cooperatives. The Thrift and Credit Cooperative Societies are the pioneers of providing financial services in Sri Lanka. They were established in 1906. And currently there are over 8,000 societies with a total membership of about 800,000. And there are cooperative rural banks with a network of over 2,000 banks. And in addition, there are a large number of NGOs and organizations that are registered as private companies or societies providing microfinance, particularly to low-income groups. But only a handful of these organizations are at the moment operating at the national level. Others are confined their activities only to specific districts or divisions. And then finally, the Samurdhi Banking Network with over 1,000 banking societies serving over 1 million clients. This is also linked to the cash transfer program. So the beneficiaries of the cash transfer program known as the Samurdhi program, they all have accounts in the Samurdhi banking societies. So altogether, when you take into account all these formal and semi-formal financial institutions in the Sri Lanka, so there is a wide network of financial institutions or access points. So each of these red points represent 50 access points defined as a bank branch or a cooperative or society where clients can save money or take loans from. So this is actually based on a study that CTAP carried out in 2006. So now the situation is expected to have improved further. So basically, at that time, it was estimated there is one access point for every 1,300 people in the country, so which is relatively high level of financial access compared to many other countries in the South Asian region. So there are some variations across districts, but generally we can situation has actually improved in northern and eastern part of the country as well after 2009. So where does Sri Lanka stand within the Asian region? I'm basically looking at some of the key indicators related to financial access based on World Bank latest data. So Sri Lanka currently about 83% of the population, adult population, has a access to bank accounts. This is actually relatively higher compared to all the South Asian countries, and I didn't actually see unfortunately the ranking for Sri Lanka in Mandira's presentation, since there was no data related to certain aspects of financial inclusion. And when you look at the share of women with access to bank accounts, it's again 83%, so which is much higher compared to other South Asian countries. And share of adults who have borrowed within the past year, it is 18%. Still, I think it's quite high compared to many other South Asian countries and some East Asian countries as well. So this is the situation of Sri Lanka compared to average South Asia and East Asia Pacific. So basically, even among the lowest 40% of the people, about 80% have bank accounts. And even adults living in rural areas, 83% have bank accounts, so which is actually relatively higher compared to the South Asian averages. So let me share with you some of the key findings based on a small panel household survey that I carried out in three districts of the country. Basically to look at the extent of access to financial services and how it has changed over time. So actually the two periods were 2006-07 and 2009-10. Unfortunately, I didn't have funds to carry it out in recent years for a third wave. So what we find, this is one of the findings, so what we find is by 2009-10 in this sample, 98% of the households in these three districts had savings accounts or had outstanding loans with financial institutions. So only 2% of the households did not have accessed financial institutions, so which has been an actually improvement since the first round of the survey, which were 8% of the household who did not have access to financial institutions. So on average, household had access about 3 financial institutions at a time, with about 33% having access 4 to 9 financial institutions for savings or loans. So these are actually households who had a bank account or outstanding loans at the time of conducting the survey. So this again shows high level of access to financial institutions as well as use of multiple financial institutions by households for loans and savings. So when I disaggregated this by number of financial institutions, access for savings and loans, what I find is about 97% had savings account, households had savings account, so which is an increase from 87% in 2006-07. And around 75% of the households had savings accounts in multiple financial institutions, with over 40% having accounts between 3 to 7 financial institutions at the time. So with regard to borrowing, what we find is in this particular, in this sample, in the first round, about 55% of the households had outstanding loans. But by 2009-10, 75% had actually outstanding loans with financial institutions, and nearly 50% of them had borrowed from multiple financial institutions, with some have borrowed from 3 to 7 financial institutions at a time. So this shows a significant increase in multiple borrowing actually at the household level. So I also looked at the kind of financial institutions these households had access for savings and loans, and how the pattern has changed over time. So what I find is, interestingly, by 2009-10, by the second round of the survey, about 54% of the households had saved with a combination of formal financial institutions and microfinance institutions. So which is actually considerably higher compared to the first round of the survey, where 32% have saved in a combination of MFIs and formal financial institutions. And similarly, with regard to loans, what we find is by 2009-10, about 32% have borrowed from a combination of MFIs and formal financial institutions. And in the first round of the survey, that was only 7%. So considerable increase of multiple borrowing, as well as considerable increase in the overlap between the formal financial institutions and the microfinance organizations. So this is actually, interestingly, we find this pattern, even a considerable share of households accessing MFIs and formal financial institutions across all the income groups. So this is actually somewhat different to what we generally expect, that the formal financial institutions and the microfinance institutions tend to serve distinct segments of the population. So what we find in Sri Lanka is over time, perhaps Sri Lanka is also now moved into a middle income, sort of lower middle income country. So over time, what we find is that these two sectors have in a way come together to serve sort of a broader needs of a broader set of households with a broader set of financial instruments. So I also try to look at actually why they borrow from multiple financial institutions and why they borrow from a mix of MFIs and CFIs. So there are a number of factors that I found, so I'll try to sort of summarize it in this diagram. So there are a number of demand side factors. So one reason to access multiple financial institutions, and in particular accessing a mix of MFIs and CFI, is to access diverse products. So what I find is actually even those who from lower income groups, while accessing microfinance institutions for various loan products, they access formal financial institutions for a different set of products, like pawning facilities. I mean, about 10 years ago, pawning was largely provided by informal pawn brokers, but now it's largely the formal financial institutions. And pawning is actually pawning gold jewelry, basically loans against gold jewelry. It's one of the very important financial products provided by commercial banks. And it is widely used among low-income households for their emergency needs, as well as for sometimes even investment needs when they need some money. So they pawn jewelry. So pawning and also leasing. So there has been a growth of leasing companies, and particularly there has been a growth of micro-leasing. So by the regulated leasing companies. So other reasons I found was to build a lump sum, to have frequent access to credit and cross fund. These are some of the reasons why people borrow from multiple institutions. And also supply side factors, obviously, is because there has been a growth of financial institutions and growth of products and certain marketing strategies by various financial institutions have also contributed to this situation. So why multiple savings? So saving in multiple financial institutions is also driven by a mix of reasons. So what I find is actually some households, one reason for actually many households to save in microfinance institutions while saving in formal financial institutions is to have access to loans, because many microfinance institutions prefer, or actually it is compulsory for them, to have savings accounts. So they have savings accounts in multiple MFIs to have access to multiple loans. But they, when it comes to saving, their preference is actually, if they have access to formal financial, the preference is the formal financial institution. But they save with MFIs to have access to multiple loans. So there are other reasons, you know, they may open a savings account in a formal financial institution because they want to have access to different services and products that they cannot access from MFIs, like current account services or foreign exchange or remittance services, which are not provided usually by the MFIs. So regardless of, now despite these considerable access to loans and savings by at the household level, there are a number of issues and challenges in the financial sector in Sri Lanka that needs to be addressed. So despite the considerable access to loans and savings, still the insurance coverage is actually quite low, and also use of remittances through formal financial institutions is still low. Maybe it's actually higher than in Indonesia, but still only about 20% of the population are covered by insurance. And if you look at the insurance penetration and density, we find that Sri Lanka relatively is at a lower level compared to other South Asian, many other South Asian countries. So some of the reasons for this is lack of awareness of the benefits of insurance and considering insurance simply as a risk management strategy, not as an investment strategy, because you get the benefits only if something happens. So there is no incentive for many to invest in an insurance thing. And other issue is actually still the use of digital financial services like mobile accounts and debit cards, ATM, credit card, e-payments and all that is relatively low. There has been an increase in the percentage of population using debit cards and credit cards in recent years. We can see that at the moment about 25% have access to debit card and use ATM facilities, but it's still relatively low compared to the level of financial access or access to bank accounts in the country. And also especially mobile accounts, only 0.1% have access to mobile accounts. So perhaps it's not, if you have a bank close by, perhaps this is also not considered important, or it is also due to sort of relatively low knowledge on technology, and there are many reasons that may have contributed to this situation. So other things that needs to be improved is actually the regulatory framework of the current microfinance sector. So even though we have a strong regulatory framework for the formal financial sector, so at the moment the microfinance sector, the regulation is framework is somewhat weak and is fragmented with different departments or different ministries acts regulating different types of microfinance institutions. So there is no sort of uniform body. So this is and some microfinance institutions like the except the cooperatives and the Samurdhi banks, which are established under a special act of parliament, others are not permitted to mobilize savings, so which is also a problem for the growth of the sector. So another issue of concern is actually some studies based on some of my previous studies have shown that there is has been an increase in the debt income ratio among the borrowers, particularly among the multiple borrowers. So even though on overall the debt levels remain at a fairly moderate level, so this is an issue of concern given the increasing level of multiple borrowing in the sector, particularly in the microfinance sector. And adding to this, there is no sort of mechanism in place to monitor the multiple borrowing and share credit information for MFIs. At the moment, the credit information bureau that we have, it is only mandatory for the formal financial institutions to be members and share credit information, but there is no such mechanism for the microfinance sector. So despite the high level of access to finance by individuals and households, many SMEs are also faced with barriers to access to adequate loans from financial institutions. This is also another thing, and there is much scope to be improved when it comes to the quality of financial services. So that's another area. So concluding, so currently there is a wide network of formal and semi-formal financial institutions and high level of outreach of financial institutions. And we can see that the access to and utilization of loans and savings facilities from financial institutions is quite high, with many households accessing multiple financial institutions and a mix of MFIs and semi-formal financial institutions. However, much remains to be done in terms of improving access to other financial services like insurance and use of remittances and digital services, and strengthening regulatory environment, improving the quality of products, and so on and so forth. So with those thoughts, let me conclude my presentation. Thank you very much.